I had a technology, small Agile transformation company. I had the technology practice for a company called Lightspeed. We are based in Washington, D.C. And I'm here to share some of my experiences with exploratory testing. You all heard the term exploratory testing? Yeah? Okay. All right. A little bit about my background. So I've been in the software development arena for about 20 years, and the past 12 years of which I've been primarily in using Agile methods. So my background is development, so my introduction to Agile was through XP in 2002, the early days. And since then, I've been primarily worked in organizations doing a lot of development and leadership positions since then using Scrum XP methods and so forth. more recently, I don't do a whole lot of hands-on development anymore, unfortunately, because I'm a coach, just like, you know, I'm sure you guys have like 100 different coaches there. There are some coaches here. How many coaches here? Lots of coaches. So. And how many developers? Testers? Oh, good. Nice. So I do a lot of coaching, technical coaching in the U.S. federal space. It's a large transformation, and I'm here to share a little bit about exploratory testing and some of the things that we are trying in the U.S. federal space in terms of exploratory testing. Okay. The outline, as I mentioned, just give a brief introduction as to what exploratory testing is. We'll take a quick survey as to see, I need to get a sense of what your knowledge is about exploratory testing, and then we'll adjust the content based on that. Look at the different aspects of exploratory testing and share my adoption experience, some of the failures, some of the successes. And the outcome is, I hope, that I demystify the practice of exploratory testing, and because it's become a fashionable term these days, I'm exploratory testing. And then also maybe provide some nuggets of ideas for you to go back and try, right? If you're here and you don't go back and try, well, that's wasted time. All right, how many of you are aware of the testing pyramid? Everybody knows it. These days, it's old news. But reality, I guess, is most organizations, we have the nice kulfi ice cream cone, right? It's true in my organizations for sure. Only one? Yeah, lots of places. So lots of scripted, pre-designed test cases, manually being executed, seem to be the predominant testing paradigm in a lot of organizations. And then automation, of course, you know, you have coaches saying automation is important for agility and so forth, but a lot of our automation endeavors are squarely about UI automation, Selenium tests and so forth. And probably no unit testing at all. Forget about TDD, that's long shot, right? Who does TDD? Good, yeah, so I said somewhere. I was glad to hear that. Anyway, so this is not a desirable pattern for sure, but coming back to our suggested testing paradigm, which is based on the pyramid, our focus is going to be about exploratory testing, the nice little white cloud at the top. At this time, I'm going to ask you, what does exploratory testing mean to you guys? Who's using exploratory testing within their organization? Can you just... It's called differently. I'm going to write these things down. So what's called differently? What? Okay, and what are some of the, what does it mean? So something random. Okay. Just a fancy word for something random. Okay, something random. All right, anybody else? Smoke testing. Random. Random is the prevalent theme, right? Smoke testing, anything else? Let's take a few more. Session-based test management. Session-based test management. Ooh, I like that.
Discovering to test.
Can I use this in some other future presentation?
Discovering to test.
Let's leave it as that. That's a good one.
Okay, so some interesting answers. Random, it's session-based test management, discovering how to test. There's truth in various degrees in all of those answers. So let me start with what exploratory testing is not. Exploratory testing is not doing random stuff. So we've got to debunk this a little bit. Okay. There's a certain level of, I won't call it randomness, but we'll get to that in a second. There is a structure and there's test discipline that you bring to the practice, but it's definitely not madly flailing at the keyboard and just putting shoes on the keyboard and seeing what happens, things like that. You know, it's not that unstructured. It's not repetitive. You already mentioned that. What do we mean by it's not repetitive? That means you're not creating long test cases based on requirements upfront for reuse at a later time that you can go on executing over and over as a smoke test or a manual repeating the same thing. Click on this button, see this, click on, you know, that sort of stuff. It's not about being repetitive. And it's not about, well, these two sort of go hand in hand. It's not about producing comprehensive test cases by your QA organization and for use at a later time. And it's definitely not about replacing what the practices that you have in place. Right? A disciplined approach to exploratory testing can augment your current test practices. Perhaps eliminate a little bit of this randomness. If it's working for you the way it is, that's fine. Right? But perhaps there are ideas expressed within the practice of exploratory testing that you can sort of augment your own testing practices within your organization. So what exploratory testing is, the definition is quite simple, and it's easy to put up in a PowerPoint. It's simultaneously learning about the system that you're testing or the functionality, and as the gentleman said, discovering what exactly are you trying to test, discovering the kind of the test practices that you're going to bring to bear, designing of the test and execution of the test, all of them happening simultaneously. Okay, that's the true definition of exploratory testing. And then using, you interpret, you run a scenario of some sort, you look at the results, then you either adjust your test cases or you report an issue or a certain finding. But it all happens dynamically, adaptively, and it's not a repetitive cycle. Okay. So having said that, the question is, did you want that? why do we care? Right? Any thoughts? We're not bringing a new discipline. I mean, you still use the existing testing best practices that your testers and the cognitive capability that they have. They bring it all to the table in exploratory testing. But why do we care about doing these things simultaneously instead of being a staged execution? Any thoughts? A living test, can you elaborate? Okay, so it's more action oriented, right? A lot of this designing of the test, all that is happening as you execute instead of just when you're planning to execute, right? That's a good answer. There's a bias towards action. Fantastic answer, because I'm not here to bash scripted testing. It has its place. It's good at verifying things that you have. Scripted testing has its place. It helps you verify that things that you have a certain expected outcome, is it being met or not? But what happens when you do that is it's good at just doing that. You know, it doesn't necessarily look at the bigger picture, things that are happening in the vicinity, but you're not so focused on that specific outcome that you're sort of oblivious to some of the obvious things that are lurking there, but that's not your focus, right? Which leads us to, okay. It'll take a minute. Okay. Because I want to sort of do a little share a video which illustrates what you just mentioned. Okay. And psychologists call this phenomena inattentive blindness. Okay. Without giving too much away, let me just wait for this. It's kind of a wrong time to stop because I need the video. Okay. So what I would like to do is I'm going to play a little snippet of a video. How many of you have seen this? No? That's good. So our job is to count the number of times, when I play the video, number of times the white team passes the basketball. Okay? That's the game. Cool? White team, how many times does it pass the ball? All right. Let's do it. Ready?
How many passes does the team in white make?
Can you guys see the video? What's the answer? 14. 13, 12, 13, 11, yeah, all within the vicinity. You start, okay. You're like, this is like a useless game. What's the point of this, right? And I think some of you are right, or at least you're in the ballpark. The answer is 13, okay? Now I'm going to ask you the question, how many of you saw a dancing bear? One, two, yeah. See, one person, two, three. Well, pretty better than when I've run this before. Okay, so there is an actual bear there, and I'm gonna just play this again. Well, it's a man in a bear costume, but. There. Anyway, so the point is exactly what you said, right? It's hard. I mean, it's easy to miss something that you're not looking for. And what's the connection with exploratory testing? You already answered it, right? When you're doing scripted testing, while it has its place, you're focused on finding the expected outcome. You may miss the things that are within the periphery because you're not focused on it. That's what psychologists call inattentive blindness. And using a technique such as exploratory testing to augment your test procedures can help maybe surface those surrounding issues or observations, okay? So, how many of you have read this book by, have heard of Elizabeth Henriksen? I love the work that she produces. And when I read this book called Explore It by Elizabeth Henriksen, it's a book that came out a couple of years ago, maybe a year ago. It was kind of a revelation because, so her hypothesis, and she's not the only one. I mean, session-based testing is based on the same principle. James Bach and Kamer. This is not a new idea, but lately it's become pretty fashionable to say exploratory testing. So her hypothesis is that testing includes more than just about verifying things. When I say verification, it's scripted, manual, or automated. Even automated testing are going to find the same thing and fail for the same thing. Yeah, they're not intelligent enough. So perhaps testing encompasses this, as well as a little bit of exploration, which, you know, is going off the script a little bit. as she says, you know, no matter how many tests you write in a scripted fashion, some interesting observations and issues can be found when you sort of go off the script, okay? So that's at the heart of exploratory testing. Now, does that mean it's fully random? Not quite. So here's a depiction of contrasting the left side, which is the verification and checking through scripts, even if it's automation or manual, and exploration. Right? And it essentially illustrates what we've just talked about. It's on the left-hand side, it's pretty well documented, either through automated scripts or your test cases, comprehensive test cases. It verifies to make sure that what was working is still working. That's its purpose. and you're doing all of this designing of these test cases up front. And in the testing continuum, exploratory testing doesn't automatically mean complete lack of structure, which is freestyle testing. Right? It's a continuum. There's aspects that, of a structure and rigor that you can build into your exploration, which is what I'd like to talk about. You're sort of still doing this learning, designing, and testing, doing all of those aspects simultaneously, not in stages. And you're testing, probing the boundaries, the peripheral aspects. And there's a chance that you're not going to be able to replicate these issues because the documentation aspect can be pretty sparse. There's no prescription for how much documentation you need to provide. It depends on your organization. Typical consultant answer, it depends. Right? All right, so the nuts and bolts of the process, if you will, for exploratory testing, at least as I sort of gleaned from reading the material and as we've tried applying it in the federal government, is what I want to share. So. the flow, four steps, and we'll sort of dissect and walk through each of these steps. As I mentioned, unscripted testing doesn't necessarily mean it's completely random. There is a little bit of a structure, and you have to prepare for it. Focusing the exploration, the four steps are focus the exploration, learn about the system capabilities, as this gentleman just mentioned, discovering to test, then designing tests with interesting variations. This is where we use existing heuristics and existing testing practices in designing tests. And then actually go ahead and attack and report your findings. You do all of these simultaneously within your session-based tests. We'll talk about session-based tests in a second. Okay? So let's start with what does it mean to focus the exploration? So again, you know, like with most things in Agile, a nice little template is available. So this is a template that Elizabeth Hendrickson, and for those of you who are not familiar with her work, I'd urge you to check out her website, testobsessed.com. I mean, she's moved away from, she doesn't maintain it a whole lot, but there's lots of wealthy information that you can sort of glean and try in your organization. But anyway, so this is called a test charter. A test charter is a simple little description that says, I'm exploring a certain area within my system, the target, with said number of resources. Resources could be what kind of an environment are you running it in? Is it your mock demo environment? Is it your UAT? What kind of test strategies are you going to apply to test that system? That's your resources. And to discover what sorts of information, right? You want to focus it, right? You don't want it to be completely open-ended, right? So that's what our test charter does. And I'll show you examples of some of the charters that we've created. So pretty straightforward. So I'll talk about how we execute our charters in a few minutes, but here's an example of some of the test charters that we've created. Again, as I said, we're in a large federal enterprise dealing with immigration forms and so forth, but we have multiple teams and they all create their test charters in that format and explore the G28 functionality using different browsers, trying to discover UI discrepancies. Seems, gives you enough of a focus to run your specific session, right? So that's it. So that's an example of a test charter, very simple, but enough guidance for a team to execute on. And the good charter should just provide that level of guidance, but not be too prescriptive, right? You don't want it to read like a test script. It's not a test case, like a lengthy Word document. Should be able to be completed in one session. In our case, our sessions last 3 hours. That's it. Right? So, because the theory is that more than 2 hours at a time, you're not going to be affected anyway for your session. So, And then this is an important one. So, and the other aspect I'd like to mention is this is not mentioned, but this is this is something that we've tried, which is we want to bring the testers to the fore, because often within Agile, as you all know, you know, the role of the tester becomes sort of nebulous. Where do they really fit? And too often, you know, developers keep cranking the code for the entire sprint, then fling the code at the end of or close to the end of the sprint boundary and say, go ahead and test it, right? Is that true? I mean, this happens in organizations, right? Yeah, right. So that's right. Probably you're doing it with the amigos, you're probably using cucumber, all of those business, gherkin, whatnot. All right. So the point is, what we have is we have the business analysts and testers before the session actually talk to our stakeholders, our product owners, and so forth, to identify which things they think are more are risky. And we look at risk parameters, which I'll show in a second, to design our charters, right? We're bringing them up front, they design the charters, and then we get into the test session. Anyway, so some good and less desirable practices when writing test charters. Any questions about focusing exploration? Simple enough? Learning about the system, right? What are you really trying to test? You have this focused area. How do I go about testing it? Even before you start designing your tests and variations, you need to understand perhaps the system's capabilities. If you already know it, maybe you don't spend a lot of time doing the learning part of it. But think about test charters where a team is about to embark on some refactoring, let's say, right? It's not about capability that they've already built. Perhaps you can have a test charter that says, what are the implications? That's a worthy test charter to spend a couple of hours. Right? So we use that quite a bit. Or if I don't understand how a certain component works, we can use a test charter to sort of focus. Right? Don't think of it as only about finding issues. It's about discovering and learning. Right? So the learning aspect is to understand the general shape of that focused area that you're going to be working on. And you can have several, depending on how you're going to execute these, you can have multiple test charters that groups of people are working on. Right? So it's not that every session you just need one test charter. No, absolutely not. So typically, I mean, we're not launching a spaceship, right? We are dealing with input, output, manipulation, and some reports, more or less, right? And we typically, I'm a big fan of mind maps. I don't know if you guys use mind maps for different things. So we typically create a mind map for the component we are working on, and it's there in our team rooms. It's not a big architectural diagram. It just gives us, the team, some idea as to what the various interactions are going to be. And then we mark the spots that we're going to explore and so forth. We may sort of rate them based on risk, which is what the different colors are. But again, nothing out of the ordinary. A simple mind map to orient our exploratory sessions. Okay? Very useful. It's a low-cost way of doing it. And the different color things that you saw there were really based on risk profiles for a given module. Like I said, we have a heavily interfaced system, and it's the shared code base. So we have a lot of issues when, you know, one team does something else, it breaks something. And this is a large transformation. I'm talking about 10 to 12 teams, about 10 people. So it's 120 folks, developers and testers. So it's pretty large. So we often can't blindly say, I'm going to pick this focus, this area to explore. We do this where we break up our software components based on risk profiles, high frequency usage, high risk. If this goes down, everything else goes down. We break it down in that manner. And that gives us some sort of a sense as to the priority of as we sort of define our charters. That's all. Again, a very simple idea. It's nothing to do with Agile or not. These are ideas coming from the testing community for many, many years. Who uses risk-based test case prioritization right now? Yeah, so same thing. You can leverage those ideas when creating a charter. So the third aspect is designing tests with interesting variations. This is where I think the tester's creativity and skill really comes to the fore. It's not about blindly executing, say click on this button, do this. That's not your strength. The real strength of the testers bring to the table is really this. How best do you design tests to sort of attack the system? And to that end, so what we use is, again, I'm going to refer back to Elizabeth Hendrickson's, and I'll share that link in a second. But we use heuristics. Heuristics are very simple guidelines that, you know, you don't have to think about it. When you're running your session, you have a certain focus area that, in our case, if it's cross-browser, discrepancies and so forth. Heuristics are simple ideas that let you sort of, if there's a form field, what are the different types of things you can explore? Entering lots of things and entering nothing. Lots of different practical suggestions to sort of vary your tests on the fly. On the fly. Remember, you're doing all of this within that session. Okay? Now, what I've depicted here is just but a small subset of what you'll find if you go to this. It's a cheat sheet that we print in our team rooms, which shows all the typical heuristics. And this is agnostic to a platform. You can apply this to whatever solution you're working on. Right? I'd highly encourage you to sort of download this. It's free for consumption. That gives you the mental model as to how you explore. And another great resource is this Jorgensen's and Whitaker's sort of post on 17 attacks. Just look for that in Google, and you will find, again, ideas for how you vary your tests on the fly. Okay? So questions about that? Straightforward so far, right? Nothing out of the ordinary. You were expecting some like newfangled thing. No. So, and finally, so you've explored the space, you've created your charter, you learned about what the intention of that specific component is. You've started to vary your tests based on heuristics, and then you're going to start playing around with it, trying the different things, and recording your observations. So some guidelines. Again, there's no prescription for how you would go about doing this, right? But some of the things that have worked for us is this. We wanted to essentially move away from this end of the game independent verification running through these manual scripts. We wanted to do this more often, early and often, run these sessions early and often, time box the session, right? This is where the session-based testing is based on the same premise. You know, you want to time box your session. And encourage pairing, right? For us, we mandate that every charter has at least two people sort of exploring that space. Right? And nobody cares if you go off the script, but you're still within the, there's no script to follow, honestly, right? You're still within the charter scope, right? You want to be within that. And documentation, again, I'll show you what we do. Maybe you have your own way of documenting the finding. Okay? So in our case, we run these sessions once a sprint, and we use a whole team approach, and I'll get to that. But we just use stickies and such to do all the observations, and then we come together and say which ones are real issues, which ones are nice to have, which ones are not an issue, and so forth. That's a collective decision before we enter tickets into JIRA and whatnot. Okay. Whatever works for you, but low documentation overhead is the key. All right. So that's really the mechanics of running exploratory testing. Right? Any questions about the mechanics of and what exploratory testing is. You never know. Yeah. Right. Somewhere else. It happens all the time. Yeah, and I think the idea is not to be too prescriptive about where to end, right? And it happens with us all the time. But we just give them the free rein, but we don't want this recording session to completely go off on tangent and somewhere. Maybe we'll just jot down quickly as to what path you took, and we'll say, hey, let's revisit it. Or maybe we'll just design a charter on the fly, and that happens too, right? If it's significant enough of a finding. So no other questions on the mechanics of the four steps? So now that we understand how exploratory testing is conducted with the focus and the learning and the design with heuristics and attacking it, how do you run this in a time-boxed manner? And that's what I'll sort of share. And again, this is the story of what we are trying to do. We've just started doing this 8 months ago, or a year ago, maybe. So there's already changes that we've made to the approach, but I'll share what we're doing. Okay? As I mentioned, so this is in the federal space, 120 people, 10 to 12 teams, and highly interface systems. Okay, so it's not where 10 teams have 10 different product lines. It's a shared product line, so it makes it particularly a big challenge as code is added and removed and so forth as to how it affects the other aspects. So our primary mission was this, right? Before we started the exploratory testing sessions, we had some level of automation, still somewhat of a kulfi cone, but still we had some automation, and we had lots of manual scripted testing, but it was all done towards when we the release part. We release every 3 months, so it's not like it's 1 year release, but still we felt like it was just too long. They were waiting, and then we also have IV and V teams. How many of you have independent verification teams here? No? Your testers are embedded within your teams. So we had the same thing. So these bug bashes that I call are like the testers within the teams executing these. And then we also, because we're in the federal space, we have compliance. There's an independent test group that does all of this stuff at the end. Anyway, the point is a lot of it was being done at the tail end. So the hypothesis was that we want to essentially make everybody responsible for executing tests, exploratory tests, participate in ET sessions, including the developers and the BAs and the testers. And we want to do it on a cadence, early and often. And the hope, hypothesis, is that we're going to surface some of these things that were being found late earlier and that there's higher confidence in our software. That was our hypothesis for running this. So to that end, our approach was this. Yeah, 15 minutes, right on time. So our approach was 10 teams, synchronized cadence across all 10 teams. What I mean is already we run the 10 teams. We have synchronized cadence in terms of our sprints. We do 2 week sprints. And also we wanted to make sure that the exploratory test sessions were also done on a certain cadence because of the fact that that way all of the different interactions across teams, because they're highly dependent, could all be discovered. While that's coming up, so that's what I mean by synchronized cadence. Yeah, everybody does it, and we typically do this at the beginning of our sprint. Two week sprint is what we run. At the first or second day of the sprint, after the planning sessions, is when we run our sessions, and it's 3 hours, and I'll get to the details in a second. And the second aspect is we give complete autonomy to the team to come up with the test charters, right? So again, encouraging the testers and the BAs to sort of come front and be a little more involved upfront in driving quality concerns upstream instead of being in the tail end. And then we've time boxed the session, and I'll talk about that in a second. Is this not going to come up now? But I think some of this, I mean, these slides, if it's useful to you guys, I'm happy to share them. But let me go through so that in the interest of time, I can take some questions. So talking about synchronized cadence, as I said, 3 hours of sprint, no more than half a day is what we've, again, it's a negotiation with the teams. If you go back to your leadership team, will they give you 3-4 hours for the entire team to participate in ET? I don't know the answer to that. For us, it was a challenge because they're saying, hey, developers need to be just cranking out code, right? That's their job. That's what I'm paying them now. So it will be a little bit of a challenge, perhaps. It was a challenge for us. But anyway, we got the commitment to have 3 hours of sprint for the entire team, 10 people, to participate in this. And like I said, it's synchronized across all of them. And test charter autonomy, again, it's about empowerment. It's about collaboration, right? So each team decides what areas to focus on. Again, they're talking with their product owners, identifying the risks and such. Charters are created by the team. Specifically, what we are sort of moving towards when I say charters are created by the team, it's really having the testers create the charters in preparation for the exploratory testing session. Right? So there's a little bit of upfront planning. It's not like you come into the session and decide the charters. We do a little bit of upfront planning where the BAs and testers will talk to the stakeholders and say, what are the risky areas? So they create their test charters. And also interesting, it's important because if you go back to that test charter template, it's about the area you're focusing on, and what kind of resources, what kind of environment are you going to run it, what kind of data sets do you need? These are all implications. If you're doing performance testing, the data set needs are different, right? So the testers are sort of helping prep the environment as well, right? So So you don't come into the session cold because you're getting all the entire team to participate in the session. So it's easier said than done, right? Creating the focus, the charts and such is the easy part. Getting your environments ready for conducting this, that may take some time. So a little bit of upfront preparation. Okay. So that's about the charter autonomy. And then, so now that we have the undivided attention of the team, what we do is, for the 3 hours that leadership granted to us to say, yeah, go ahead and do this, we break it up into two parts. 2 hours of execution and recording. So all 10 teams are going to go back, go into their own spaces, or sometimes we do it collectively, and they start executing on their charters. and this is where, again, testers are the ones who help the developers with some of those heuristics and such, right? So developers inherently are not very good, right, at alternate paths and so forth, but this is where testers are leading a lot of those aspects. And recording within the session, like I said, it could be sticky notes. Each team, sometimes we put it out on Confluence. We let the team decide how they're going to record it. We don't care. But once you're done with 2 hours of exploring, and there could be multiple charters, all 10 teams will come back together to a shared our Scrum of Scrums board, and all the POs will be there, and all of the findings are sort of socialized. Right? By that time, the BAs and testers have already distilled all the what are true defects, what are enhancements, what are some questions for the PO, all of that happens. And oftentimes there can be a lot of overlap. You don't want to bring all of that to the table here. So all of that stuff happens with some leadership and shepherding by the BAs and the testers. If we summarize and report, it's almost like a stand-up, if you will, with all the peers that are Scrum board. And that's why the earlier picture that I showed, we had the test sessions for the different, the charters for the different sessions and the findings, right? So it could be screen captures, it could be questions, we don't care, whatever it is, that's discussed and prioritized accordingly, right? So some of the things that are found are not always issues. Some of them could be ideas for improvement. Some of them may not be bugs at all. Maybe things are working as intended, you know. So all of those conversations happen. No, right. But when you say clubbing, so oftentimes, or maybe if I'm understanding your question, if there's some things that were found which are blatant issues, what's the next step? Perhaps it's worth it to sort of automate this, right? Capture. Yeah, absolutely. We do that all the time. The test for bug initiative, that's probably something that we all do, right? When things are found, if it's critical enough, before fixing the problem, you capture it as a test, as an automated test. But not every finding is going to be a bug, is my point, right? So, okay? Absolutely, good point though. Test for bug, good way to bolster your regression suite. Okay, simple enough. Again, nothing earth-shatteringly complex here. So the benefits we've gleaned from this is unleashing the creativity, bringing the testers, making them more empowered and part and parcel, instead of just being at the tail end of being dumped stories and so forth, right? So that helped a lot with that. And being able to provide quick feedback to the developers, because they're also participating in it, right? So that was, to us, this really has been the big benefit, these two. The rapid feedback, the engagement of the developers, and testers feeling more empowered. Before you get into the session, right? There's only 2 hours. So, and each team does it differently. What I've seen is typically, because we know that it's on a cadence. We do it every sprint, right? It's like another ceremony, if you will. So they already know that they have to create the charters. And once they create the charters, let's say I'm doing performance testing with some data set requirements. So the team will have to reach out to the ops people to make sure that the particular, yeah. Yeah. No, not quite the possible way. You're just creating the charter. No, not all the rest of it happens dynamically, right? Just the charter and the environment prep. The challenges, again, you know, the mileage varies. Depending, this is a highly cognitive process. It depends on the skill of your testers, you know, how interesting variations you can create. So all of that, it depends. It's a highly cognitive process. And also the fact that sometimes we couldn't repeat things, to your point, you know, sometimes you found something, maybe you stop, And we couldn't recreate the problem. These are some challenges we're continuing to face because the less emphasis on documentation, if you will. So in summary, really, that's all I really wanted to share about that little story as to how we engaged the entire team to participate in this. And I kind of like this quote by James Bach, another guy who's, there's three people who are like thought leaders in the space, James Bach, Elizabeth Henriksen, and Ken Kamer. So they, you know, you can look up material on exploratory testing, you'll find lots of information. Anyway, so he sort of compares it to like fishing, right? Like fishermen, you're always trying to study the water, see where the next tasty meal is, you cast the net. Similarly, you know, that's what you're really doing with the exploratory testing session. So, and what we found is it definitely helped us surface the risks sooner for sure. The fact that it's highly adaptive, not prescriptive, was of the benefit. And it's not like we tossed away all of our manual testing efforts, meaning the scripted efforts or the automation. All that stays in place. And we are somehow able to make this fit within our Agile cadence. Right? The next step, what we want to do is, I mentioned the independent testing teams. They're still very traditional testers, right? Lots of test cases and requirements. The problem is in the Agile context, we don't have, the requirements are a little fluid, so they're struggling to come up with all these test cases up front. You're trying to have them run 1 week cadences where they essentially follow the same pattern. Right. So that's our current experiment. 1 week sessions for the traditional, independent testers. So that's it. Any questions, thoughts? Yeah. Continuous deployment, you're not saying continuous delivery, right? And that's a great question, right? I mean, is Google and Netflix and Flickr, these guys are doing 20 deployments a day, are they necessarily doing exploratory? Perhaps not, right? Because everything is fully automated. So I don't have a ready answer for you to see as to where it fits. But what we are moving towards is a continuous delivery. And so we want to get to weekly pushes and so forth in the federal space, which is a big deal. So what we do is we have our, these sessions sort of lag behind a little bit. Right? We have to, you know, essentially, we ought to make do. So I'll definitely answer your question. Maybe we can have a conversation right after. It looks like the others are in. Yeah, I'll be here. All right. Well, thank you so much for your participation. All right, thanks. All right. Hopefully it was useful.